Good morning, everybody. Why don't we stand and worship today? If you're watching online, welcome. It's good to see you all. Here we go. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. It's great to see you here this morning. My name is Doug Mill, and I'm the senior pastor here at Plattsburgh Nazarene. It's great to see you. Keep inviting people to join us, not only in person, but also to be part of our services online as well. Inside your bulletin, there's a connection card that we'd love for you to, if you have updated information you want to share with us, you can fill that out. Tear it off and then put it in one of the offering boxes around the building. If you're a guest with us today, we especially encourage you to take care of that for us so we can get your name and address and contact information. If you brought tithes and offerings with you today, you can put those in the boxes also throughout the building. You can also utilize our online giving option through the church website. On July, on Sunday, July 21st at 4:30 p.m., we're going to have a baptism service at Macomb Park. We plan to share a meal together after that, so please bring something with you, and you can sign up for all of that in the foyer. Signing up for who's going to be coming as far as attendance and also what you're bringing, that would be really helpful to us. So if you could sign up in the foyer on the sign-up sheet, that would be great. If you are looking to be baptized, candidates need to meet with me before that event even happens, so make sure that you contact the church office or me directly, and we can make sure that we know that you're interested in being baptized. Children's Church is running through the summer, and we need your help with that. And so in order to make that work, we need people who are dedicated helpers in Children's Church. The lessons are already prepared for you. Everything is there. You just need to get it and look at it. If you are interested in helping out, you can see our discipleship director, Katie Calkins, or you can talk to our children's director, Sue Rothamel, about that. For the nursery today, if you're used to using our nursery, all the nurseries will be downstairs today, so there's no upstairs nursery. But if you're going to utilize the nursery today, just go downstairs, the hallway off the foyer. That's what you want to do. Now, coming here, I found out that this church gives scholarships to students who are looking to advance their education. I thought, what a blessing that is, that a church can do that. And so we have four scholarship award, I don't want to say winners, but they've filled out the application and scholarship committee met. And so I want to invite those four to come up so they could receive their scholarship from Plattsburgh Church of the Nazarene. Andrew Denial, if they could come up here. Oh, you're in the back. Well, too bad. Come up here anyway. Andrew Denial, Zach Dubre, if you'd come up here as well. Candace Gifford, I saw Candace come in there. Good. Excellent. And Nathan Weber. Oh, take the short path over the balcony, Nathan. Why don't you do that? I'll work slow. Yeah, he is a tall fella, isn't he? As Nate is walking up here, would you give these folks a round of applause? Zach, congratulations. Candace, you almost stood in alphabetical order, so that's good. Congratulations. Now, Caleb has some announcements, so I'm going to ask Candace and Zach, you can sit because you didn't graduate from high school, but these two did. And if you graduated from high school, would you come up? Because Caleb has a presentation he'd like to make.
I think, yeah, Kaylee, if you can come up here, and then Harrison's not here today. Yeah. So today, we get to also recognize our high school graduates. You want to give them a quick hand? That's pretty impressive. Pretty great. So I just want to begin by saying how happy we are as a church to see you get to this point. But being a teenager in today's world, it's not fun. So getting to where you are today is such a great accomplishment. And it's pretty neat because I look at these young people here, and I actually remember pretty much all of them from when they were little in children's church. And how is that so? Because, well, I was the big kid in children's church at that time. And I had the opportunity to kind of be the example for this group. And thankfully, they didn't follow it because we're congratulating them today. Isn't that awesome? That's great. That's awesome. So I taught them what not to do in life. That's awesome. So anyway, as you prepare for the start of your next chapter here, I just want to tell you a couple things, really, that I wish someone told me when I was graduating. I wish I heard at my graduation, actually, is what it really is. So the first thing is that success is not solely defined by accolades or achievements. Ultimately, success is about aligning our lives with God's purpose and seeking Him above all else and living a life that brings glory to Him. And the second thing I want to tell you is to never forget the importance of faith. And hold on to what we believe and strengthen your relationship with God. And let your faith be that anchor that grounds you into life's storms in life. Because being a teenager is pretty difficult. You can ask anybody here. Being an adult is not that much easier. It brings a whole new set of challenges. So with that being said, trust in God's plan for your life. Lean on Him for guidance, wisdom, and strength. And lean on your church family as well. We as a church, we're called to support the whole body, right? And that includes our young adults here. So let's be that support for these youngins. Sound good? So we have some gifts for you guys, but first, before we get to that, I'm going to pass the mic here. We're going to start with you. Why don't you just tell me where you graduated from and what's next? What's next for you? Just those two things, okay? Can you do that? All right, good.
All right. I don't know.
What's your name, first of all?
My name is Josh Gaborio. I just graduated, or about to graduate, from Saranac High School, and I'll be attending SUNY Plattsburgh for business administration and running on the track team.
My name is Andrew Denial. I am about to graduate from Saranac, and I'll be attending Cedarville University and majoring in computer science next year.
I am Nathan Weber. I'm about to graduate from Saranac High School, and I'm going to be attending SUNY Plattsburgh Undeclared.
I'm Keely Dubre. I graduated Beaventown High School, and I'm going to SUNY Plattsburgh Undeclared, but I want to do something with criminal justice.
I'm Taylor Boris. I'm graduating from Beaventown High School, and I'm hopefully going to be working for the school.
Thank you.
All right, let's stand up and continue to worship.
Oh,
Amen. You may be seated.
This morning for our prayer time, I thought it would be great if we could have our seniors, have our seniors come back up here and kneel if they could, and family members, parents, support people, if you would get kind of lay your hands on them, that would be great. And if you have other concerns or needs and you'd like to come up, that would be great as well. Let's prepare our hearts for prayer this morning. Pray for our seniors. It would be great. But also, you've got concerns as well. And so let's be in prayer. As I lead, you be praying as well. Sneak right on in there. That's great. Let's pray together this morning, shall we? Lord Jesus, thank you so much for a community that believes in our students and our children and our toddlers and our babies. And we thank you for the opportunity we have to gather together to pray for our seniors this morning. Lord, we pray for them as they take another step in their walk of life and their walk with you as they pursue the things post-high school. We pray for the families, and we pray for their parents and their guardians and their extended families as they surround their student with love and support, but also with the knowledge that they're growing up. They're taking the next step toward young adulthood. And so we pray for that transition. We pray for our families today. We pray for our church family today. And we know that we are representative of a host of different situations and circumstances. And so, Lord, we pray that you would walk with us, that you would walk alongside of us, and where we need you to kind of hold our hand, we pray that you would do that. Maybe you need to carry us. Maybe we need to stop and just spend time with you on the journey. Whatever part we're walking on, wherever we find ourselves in that journey, Lord, we pray that you would draw close to us, that we would sense your presence, that we would be open and honest with you, that we would submit to your will and to your way, and that we would live the life worthy of the name Christian. Lord, we thank you for this church, and we pray in the days ahead that you would continue to help us to lift you high, that we would see spiritual growth, and we'd see numerical growth, and we would see people coming to you and drawing closer to you. Not just people who have been here for a long time, that would be great, but people from outside that are just looking for a place to be part and to worship you in a community. Lord, as we wait for those to come in, may we recognize that we are a sent people. And so help us to go and to share and to live the gospel in all that we say and do. Lord, we're so thankful for the songs that we have sung already this morning, the worship that we've had, and we pray that you would help us during our children's church time. We pray you'd bless our children and our children's workers, that you would minister to us, you would bless us as we hear your word opened up to us this morning. Lord, thank you for all that you have done. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing here and now, and thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Our children are dismissed for children's church. Last week I told you that we would be spending time looking through the second part of chapter 5 of Paul's letter to the Galatians. And so we're going to be looking at that all summer long, right? We're going to look at the fruit of the Spirit. It's not individual fruits. It's a fruit of the Spirit. And so it's just described in different ways. And so as we're doing that in here, our children are going to be learning about that in children's church too, which is great. So I told you, be in prayer. You should be in prayer for church anyway, right? But be in prayer specifically for these services about the fruit of the Spirit. And so I'm going to look at the second part of that. This is the first week of us looking at Galatians 5, 13 through 26. I've chosen this morning the New Century Version. Hey, look, translations are great, right? I'm going to use a different translation probably every time I preach, but I wanted to open up with this one from the New Century Version. So if you'd like to open up your Bibles and look at 5, 13 through 26, you go ahead and you can see the comparison. But I've got the New Century Version up here for us. Galatians 5, 13 through 26 is what Paul writes. My brothers and sisters, God called you to be free, but do not use your freedom as an excuse to do what pleases your sinful self. Serve each other with love. The whole law is made complete in this one command: love your neighbor as you love yourself. If you go on hurting each other and tearing each other apart, be careful, or you will completely destroy each other. So I tell you, live by following the Spirit. Then you will not do what your sinful selves want. Our sinful selves want what is against or contrary or contradictory against the Spirit. And the Spirit wants what is against our sinful selves. The two are against each other, so you cannot do just what you please. But if the Spirit is leading you, you are not under the law. The wrong things the sinful self does are clear: being sexually unfaithful, not being pure, taking part in sexual sins, worshiping gods, doing witchcraft, hating, making trouble, being jealous, being angry, being selfish, making people angry with each other, causing divisions among people, feeling envy, being drunk, having wild and wasteful parties, and doing other things like these. I warn you now, as I warned you before, those who do these things will not inherit God's kingdom. But the Spirit produces the fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. There is no law that says these things are wrong. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified their own sinful selves. They have given up their old selfish feelings and the evil things they wanted to do. We get our new life from the Spirit, so we should follow the Spirit. We must not be proud or make trouble with each other or be jealous of each other. Let's pray together. And now, Lord, open my mouth so that I can speak. Open our ears so that we can hear, and open our hearts so that we can change. By your power and through your grace, amen. A few years ago, I believe you were given a book called Believe. And if you don't have that, you could pick one up. I think we have some here. You could make a request. But Greg Withrow is the one who told me about this. And so in that book, the author actually goes through the fruit of the Spirit. And so if you have that book, you can read ahead, right? We're going right in order with the nine that are here. And so feel free to read in advance if you'd like to. So based on that passage, my question to you is, so what? Why should any of us care about the fruit of the Spirit, or about the Galatians, or about the Apostle Paul and what he was trying to get across to these people? Well, for starters, it's interesting because what Paul described here was basic human decency. Just being a good human being. Today, we often gripe about the loss of morality in our society, the lack of a general conscientiousness, the absence of a social and communal conscience, the blatant disrespect for authority, our ever-disappearing charitable discourse with one another, our collective poor understanding of risk and consequence, the disappearance of the basics of right and wrong, a scarcity of manners, a disregard for one another, the loss of relationships and friendships, and the neglect of helping those less fortunate. Sadly, we often forget that we are living in a society with one another, and that society must work together and function together if it wants to survive. So in this portion of his letter to the Galatians, Paul revisited some of his earlier themes in the letter, but he also presented some ideas here about basic human decency. For example, do not use your freedom as an excuse to do what pleases your sinful self. We have done a great deal of damage to one another throughout history by using personal freedom as an excuse to oppress another person or group of persons. The freedoms we have as human beings can never be used as an excuse for selfish and harmful behavior. Basic human decency dictates that we keep our selfishness to a minimum, because selfishness only leads to hurt and oppression. Following through on our selfish desires on a constant basis only hurts those around us, and it is the cause of all those isms we live with in our culture. We must steer clear of using our freedom as a weapon against another person. The Apostle Paul was no dummy. Not only was he well-educated in the Jewish law and Christian theology, but he was well-educated in civics and the ideals of being part of the Roman populace. Paul knew what it took to be a good, practicing Jewish person. Paul knew what it took to be a good disciple of Jesus Christ. And Paul knew what it took to be a good citizen living out his freedoms, but without using those freedoms as a weapon against another human being. Our actions can be weapons against another person. Our attitude can be a weapon against another person. Our words can be weapons against another person. To be a decent human being requires us to keep all of those in check, which is why societies all over the world have created basic societal laws for everyone to follow. As human beings, we cannot use our freedom as an excuse to see another person suffer. Our freedom must avoid becoming an oppressive power exercised over other people. We must be mindful of how we use our freedoms lived out in society, and because we have an obligation to practice human decency, even when there are those around us who don't practice human decency. And Paul continued with verse 15. Hurting leads to tearing down one another, which leads to destroying one another. I hate watching the news, but Kristen has to watch the news at 10 o'clock every night. At 10 p.m., I typically excuse myself from the living room so that I don't have to be a witness to the awful events that are happening in our community. Not because I'd rather be ignorant, but because I don't need to hear about all the new and terrible stuff that we humans are doing to each other. Our social media outlets are filled with all sorts of that crummy stuff, and for the most part, I've just kind of stopped scrolling. Our hurting one another leads to tearing others down. and that leads to destroying another person. And while the Apostle Paul could certainly be referring to actual physical hurt here in the passage, my educated guess is that he was speaking directly about the words that we use toward one another. To be a decent human being is to be a human who acts decently toward other people. After all, we are part of the same human race. Hurting people, especially to preserve one's own freedom and one's own self-preservation, is not the way of decent humanity. When we inflict harm by exercising our freedom, we flip freedom on its head and use it for something it was not created for. My freedom cannot serve to enslave you, and your freedom cannot serve to enslave me or others. To burden someone else through the exercising of my freedom serves only to tear another person down. And when that tearing down happens often enough and happens on a consistent basis, it often leads to an individual's destruction. Human beings do not seek the destruction of another. Rather, they seek to see others built up, to see others succeed and do well, and to see others become good and decent persons of society. All of those actions are actions of basic human decency. Wishing and hoping for others to do well and to press on and to strive for goodness for the entire human race. After all, we need one another. We need one another to learn and to grow, to build and to expand, to advance and to move forward. To act differently is more inhuman than it is to be human. And in the middle of this portion of the letter, Paul got very, very specific. Now, we can adequately assume that Paul was using the verbs in verse 10 as, say, general examples of what not to do. However, Paul always wrote with purpose and intention. So it would make more sense to treat these very specific verbs that he puts here as actions that he understood the Galatians to be practicing. In verse 20, Paul used the following verbs: hating, making trouble, being jealous, being angry, being selfish, making people angry with each other, causing divisions among people. To act in these ways neglects the very foundation of basic human decency. Take a look around our country and our world to see the results of human beings hating each other. Take a look around our country and our world to see the results of our making trouble for other people. Take a look around our country and our world to see the results of our jealousy of others and what they have that we may not. Take a look around our country and our world to see the results of our unsettled and unresolved anger. Take a look around our country and our world to see the results of our selfish actions. Take a look around our country and our world to see how our actions and our influence and our attitude can make other people angry with other people. Take a look around our country and around our world to see how our actions and our words and our politics have created rifts and divisions between people. When we neglect to practice the ways of basic human decency, our culture and our society crumble apart. And we forget that our freedom does not come to us as a means to bring harm to another person. The rules of basic human decency still apply to the human race. We've just forgotten and neglected our priority to help others find their flourishing as human beings, living on this planet for a brief moment in time. In 1986, Robert Fulghum published what became a bestseller, All I Really Need to Know I Learned in Kindergarten. Anybody remember that book? The premise of this book, the basics of human decency are not found in one's lofty education, but rather they're found in what he calls the sandpile of Sunday school and the experimental or experiential moments of kindergarten. Here's what he learned about human decency and the need to see it so that others can find decency or experience decency and flourishing too. Share everything. Play fair. Don't hit people. Put things back where you found them. Clean up your own mess. Don't take things that aren't yours. Say you're sorry when you hurt somebody. Wash your hands before you eat. Flush. Warm cookies and cold milk are good for you. Live a balanced life. Learn some and think some and draw and paint and sing and dance and play and work every day some. Take a nap every afternoon. When you go out into the world, watch out for traffic. Hold hands and stick together. And the last one, be aware of wonder. So why is it then that as we have grown into adults, we have forgotten most of that list? We act in ways that serve to lift ourselves up rather than the other, and we lift ourselves up at the expense of the other. Life should be full of wonder and awe and care and concern and compassion and joy and flourishing, and we should work hard to see our neighbor find that same kind of life. Paul concluded this section of his letter with a final note concerning human decency. He essentially wrote, "Do not be proud or make trouble or be jealous." Interesting that Paul repeated that word jealous again at the end of this portion. My guess is that Paul saw the negative and harmful effects of jealousy and envy in his day, and he saw it happening in the Galatians. He saw the awful treatment of authority and leadership. He saw the corruption and the selfishness. He saw the oppression and he saw the abuse. And he recognized that pride and making trouble and jealousy served no purpose in building up the human race into joy and flourishing. Rather, pride, making trouble, and jealousy served only to tear people down and destroy them. Folks, what I just gave you was simply an overview of how human beings need to act and how not to act toward one another. Not only did Paul see the need for improvement in his day, but we need to work hard at improving our basic human decency in our day. And I say all of that even before we get into the Christian element of things. Without a show of hands, how many of us heard Paul addressing the basic elements of human decency and found ourselves falling short in certain areas? Don't show me hands, but I'll be the first to say, me, right? In other words, if we are neglecting those actions of basic human decency, chances are we are also missing the mark when it comes to the fruit of the Spirit. The Apostle Paul was an educated man. He was a well-rounded man. He was an intelligent and well-read man, but he was not simply a philosopher, and he was definitely not simply a humanist. Paul was a disciple of Jesus Christ. And because he was a disciple of Jesus Christ, he framed basic human decency in the context of the work of the Holy Spirit in the hearts of human beings and their outward actions toward other human beings. If Paul were just a philosopher or a humanist, he wouldn't have brought up the fruit of the Spirit, but he did, because he's a disciple of Jesus Christ. To miss the mark of both humanity and discipleship, to be a disciple of Jesus, is to live a lifestyle filled with the wrong things. The wrong things that the sinful self does. And Paul mentioned those sinful and selfish actions throughout this portion of his letter. But the good news is that Paul does not leave his reader hanging without a solution to the problem. Paul offered a very stark contrast to the life of selfishness and wrongdoing with something else. And how did he connect those two things together? He described that solution with the important conjunction, but. Here's all of this. In fact, Galatians, you're doing this. In fact, Plattsburgh, Church of the Nazarene, you might be doing this. But you don't have to. A conjunction is a word that is used to connect clauses or sentences together, or sometimes to coordinate words in the same clause. Now, I'm sure you can list these yourselves, but I've done the work for you. And, or, since, for, because, as, yet, still, while, as soon as, therefore, moreover, in case, though, although, even though, and but are all examples of conjunctions in the English language. Now, in fact, if you're of a certain age, as I'm talking about conjunctions, you might have a specific tune running through your head from the cartoon Schoolhouse Rock that featured a vignette on conjunctions. Anybody know that song? We're not going to sing it because it's church, but anyway, there it is. Conjunctions often tell the rest of the story. For example, the flowers here are white and yellow, but sometimes they are red and blue. A conjunction often completes a thought, which makes the thought clearer, more full, more descriptive, and better defined. Read any of Paul's letters and you will find conjunctions all over the place. Why? Because Paul believed that the Christian life, the Spirit-led life, was a life full of conjunctions and not a life full of contradictions. You were this way, but now you're this way. In our passage this morning, Paul laid out a number of issues that needed addressing. The Galatians were living lives contradictory to the Spirit-led life. In fact, most of Galatians 5:13 through 26 that we read this morning described a life that contradicted the holy life of a disciple. However, what is most important in this passage is the two powerful verses toward the end of the chapter, verses 22 and 23, that feature the fruit of the Spirit. Even when Paul offered reprimand and rebuke and correction, he always tried to encourage his audience. Now, this is Doug's paraphrase here, but this is essentially what Paul was getting at. True life, Paul wrote, the life of the disciple, is not about living contrary to the Holy Spirit. Rather, true life, a life full of human decency and fulfillment and flourishing and following, is a life that follows through with the conjunctions. But you Galatians are living this way, but you need to live this way because you have been called by Christ to be kingdom people and not worldly people. Do not live out the contradictions, but live out the conjunctions. Paul was in touch with culture and society, meaning he was more than able to read the signs, if you will, of the world. Very astute, very discerning. He was observant and he was perceptive. He was wise and he was fully aware of the slippery slope of living in the world, but not of the world. Folks, Paul cared about the church, which is why he was so critical of the church. He didn't want the church of Jesus Christ to live in a world of contradictions where people said one thing but acted completely different. Living as a disciple of Jesus was better than living according to the self and all of its sinful, selfish desires. Living as a disciple of Jesus was better than doing all the wrong things all the wrong time. Living as a disciple of Jesus was better than living impurely and unfaithfully. There is more to life than making our busyness a higher priority than Jesus, than performing ritualistic acts that mirror the world, than hating one another, than making trouble and getting into trouble, than being angry all the time about everyone and everything, and more than being a wedge in what could be healing and healthy relationships. Paul wrote that to act in ways contrary to the Spirit was a surefire way to lose one's inheritance and citizenship in the kingdom of God. When we act in selfish ways, we will eventually push others away and be left with, you guessed it, the self. Selfishness not only hurts the ones around us, but it also puts a wall up between us and others, creating only isolation and loneliness for ourselves. But, Paul wrote, you and I don't have to live a life of contradiction because we were created for so much more than that. We were created to live out the conjunctions and live into the Spirit-led life. So as a solution and alternative to living the contradictions, Paul wrote how to live in the conjunctions in verses 22 and 23, and he wrote this, but the Spirit produces the fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. There is no law that says these things are wrong. And notice, as I already mentioned, that Paul did not write these verses as a list of individual fruits, but he stuck with the singular fruit, karpos, fruit of the Spirit. Although we will be looking at each word separately over the next several weeks, this is not a list of separate fruits, but rather these words are descriptions of the entirety of what the Holy Spirit wants to do in us. Just as we grow in our salvation and we are called to continuously grow in love and grace, so we are to grow into the life of the Holy Spirit. The life of the Spirit looks like what Paul has listed here. The closer we get to Jesus through the Spirit, the more we look like the fruit of the Spirit. The alternative to a life of contradictions where the self is expressed without restraint or accountability is a life directed and enabled and empowered by the Holy Spirit. We are called into the conjunctions where we lived, past tense, one way, but now we live another way, under the care and nurture of the Holy Spirit. Disciples of Jesus are called and invited into freedom to serve one another in love. Disciples of Jesus are not called to indulge the self and all the desires and wants that the self requests. And just a point of order, last time I checked, I cannot always get what I want. How about you? Do you always get what you want? All the time, every time? No, because sometimes what we want is not something we need. And sometimes what we want is not good for us. And sometimes what we want, we just can't have. You don't always get what you want, but stay in tune with the Holy Spirit, so that what the Spirit wants for us, we want for us too. The Spirit wants us to produce fruit that looks and sounds like Jesus. The central question of Christianity is not, oh, is this progressive or conservative? The central question of Christianity is this Christ-like or not? In verse 25, Paul wrote, we get our new life from the Spirit, so guess what? So we should follow the Spirit. Friends, we will not find the fruit of the Spirit anywhere else but by the Spirit. So do not live out the contradictions. Live out the conjunctions. Would you bow your heads? As the worship team comes up before we sing our closing song, I asked you to pray. Pray before every Sunday when we're talking about the fruit of the Spirit, because all of us need it, right? We all need that fruit of the Spirit. We need to feed off of it and live off the Spirit. Now, maybe you have it all together, right? That's okay. But my guess is maybe we all kind of need a little tweaking, right? So we need to be in prayer about what the Spirit wants from us. We need to be in prayer about looking more like the Spirit, looking more like Jesus, than looking more like our neighbor or whoever else. And so I wonder if this morning, even as we sing this closing song, if you'd like to come and pray. If you can't kneel, that's okay. There's seats right in the front. But I wonder if you would be in prayer about not only the weeks ahead with these messages on the fruit of the Spirit, but about your own spirit, small s, and what the Spirit wants to do in you. And this is not for you to be praying for somebody across the aisle, right? I'm talking about you now. But maybe after you've prayed for yourself, maybe you in a general way would pray for the entire church community, right? Pray for everybody. So as we're praying about the fruit of the Spirit, as we're thinking about the fruit of the Spirit, these nine things, love, joy, peace, patience, and on, would you be in prayer about your own willingness to submit to the authority of the Holy Spirit this morning? Would you come and would you pray?
Pour out your power and love as we sing. holy.
Holy, holy, holy.
Thank you for being here. Be in prayer, right? About what the Spirit wants of you. Would you stand and let's sing our benediction together this morning?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and